workshop. So conditional gradients have been keeping me busy for the last 5 years. And even some colleagues complain that I only think about that once in a while, and I try to apply it to all possible problems. It is true to an extent, and today I will try to present some applications or some extensions that I've been working on the last 2 years. So before I start, I should, so we had, doesn't work. Okay. So we had the chance to have Marguerite Frank just before, and let me tell a few words about Frank-Wolfe. So I don't know if he was funny in his, does not work. I don't know if he was funny during his daily life, but he can write some, funny papers, and one should appear soon. And so essentially created the universal algorithm, which works all the time and which has optimal complexity. So it's simple. So you take any vector space, and you assume there is a dense countable subsequence in that vector space. So you can enumerate that subsequence. So essentially, to optimize, what do? You just take things, the sequence, element by element. Then you have a converging algorithm with no in all situations. So of course, it's totally totally bogus. And this, he wrote this in an anonymous paper in the 70s. And his goal was to really laugh at all the people that were doing optimization without any notion of complexity. So I think that paper is still very relevant today, not for that workshop, but maybe for other workshops. and there is a lot in that paper. It's really, really funny. So I encourage you to have a look at it. So it is behind the Springer wall. So I put it on my webpage if you want to have a look. Okay, so there will be three subparts to this talk, with three links between conditional gradients and other stuff. The first one will be between conditional gradients and subgradients, and this will be done by Fenchel duality. The second part will be a relationship between conditional gradient and greedy algorithm. And finally, this joint work with Simon Lacoste-Julien and Guillaume Obozinski, relationship between conditional gradient and herding. Okay, let's look at the problems which I will try to solve. So I'm going to look at composite optimization, where I want to minimize the sum of two terms, h of x. So I will assume that h is strongly convex, and I will assume that f is Lipschitz continuous. So I will give many examples like in the next two slides. But the key thing is that we're going to only assume that h and f are known through very specific oracles. F will be known only through subgradients, which we assume we can compute efficiently. And H will be known through subgradients or gradients of F star. And since those assumptions imply that F star, so F star is the Fenchel conjugate of the Fenchel conjugate of F. And if F is Lipschitz, F star has a compact support. And if H is strongly convex, H star is smooth. So we assume you can compute a gradient of H star. Essentially, this means that you can minimize H plus a linear function. Okay, so what is the dual problem? So this is late in the day, so I've put all of the steps. So you start with your problem. You express f as the Lipschitz Fenchel conjugate by introducing the dual variable y. Then you regroup the terms like this, and then you invert the mean and the max, and what you end up with is a Fenchel dual, which is simply maximizing minus h star of something minus f star of y. So in that talk, so for the first part, the key thing is to, when you look at that problem, when you solve this, you also solve that. Okay? So sometimes you have a better view on one side of the problem than the other. Okay, let's look at some examples. And for examples, you might either see the primal formulation as being more natural or the dual formulation. So let's look at the primal formulation. For the primal formulation, H is strongly convex and F is Lipschitz. So this includes many instances. So for example, supervised learning with a Lipschitz loss. Lipschitz loss may be used. A here is your input data. And I've given logistic is one example. And of course, all of the max margin formulations launched by Ben Tasca also applies. In fact, much of the motivation for that work comes from the work of Ben. Then also, if you're willing to specialize the problem even more, proximal operators are also a subcase of this when you take A being identity and H being this. Okay, so this in the primal formulation, this occurs in many areas of machine learning and signal processing. The one thing which is also important to me is summular functions. Okay, so this can be used to minimize summular functions, and in fact, I will show it does not. So why? You see why. Okay, so what is a summular function? It is essentially a function, a convex function defined on the vertices of the hypercube. And if you're summular, you can extend this function to the entire vector space Rn. And a key result by Lovaas is that minimizing f on the vertices of the hypercube is equivalent to minimizing it on the entire cube. So essentially, summular function minimization is a convex problem. This, however, is not very useful because f, this problem has no structure. And the key result by Fujishige in 2005 is to show that if you replace the 0-1 constraint by a strongly convex term, then if you take the unique solution of that thing, then you can, by thresholding at zero, you obtain the optimal solution of the original non-convex problem. So of course now, this you can use convex duality in the same way. So you have x, f of x, since f is convex homogeneous, it is a maximum of linear functions. You invert the mean and the max, and you obtain a formulation where you want to find a point in a polytope which has the smallest L2 norm. The problem is that polytope is huge. It has exponentially many vertices and faces. But the key thing is that you can maximize linear functions on that polytope efficiently. So it's a good candidate for Frank-Wolfe, but it's useless. So why is it useless? Because in many problems in machine learning, we say, oh, we don't need like high precision. Our functions are averages, so low precision is enough. For signal processing, often you need a very high precision. So those first order methods are typically not good enough because you need too many iterations. So essentially, for those problems, what people use is more a fully corrective version, which I will present a bit later. So this was just a small advertisement on similar functions. Then dual formulations. Okay, so here there's a very interesting aspect is that you can also see supervised learning in the dual formulation. So now H star is your logistic loss. So now we have to assume that H is a smooth convex data fitting term, logistic or least squares. For simplicity, we will consider F star being zero, okay, and C being being compact. And now what you get penalized, constrained supervised learning. And in most cases, the constraint set is obtained as a level set, is a ball in a norm. And my assumption regarding F is essentially that you can maximize linear functions on C. And in that setup, this corresponds to being able to compute the dual norm. Okay, so this is well known, and this has been applied to many norms for which omega is hard to compute, but omega star is very easy to compute. So this includes norms by Guillaume and the atomic norms of also Benrecht this morning. Also, if you want to penalize, and I will come back to that later, my framework also includes a certain form of penalization if you take that function. Okay, so if you assume that you know a bound on the optimal value of y, then that function happens to be happens to satisfy my constraints, so you can also minimize penalized problem in that form. Okay, so now let's look at the equivalence. So I will do two, first the easy one, and then the hard one. So the easy one, I will really consider a simpler problem, which is essentially the SVM objective. Okay, so if you have the SVM, it is essentially in that form. And now, if you look at the primal, what do you have? You have a function for which you can compute the subgradient, okay, which is strongly convex. So you can do subgradient descent. And this is essentially what this is written here. So the recursion, you go from time step t minus 1 to time step t by just going down the direction of a subgradient. So the gradient of this is this. The subgradient of that is equal to that. And the step size is rho t over mu. Okay, so this is plain subgradient descent with a certain step size. But now, on the dual problem, what do you have? You have a smooth function, okay, over a compact set. Yep.
Why do you have an f?
F is equal to that.
Oh, okay. You keep the
f. Okay. So on the for the dual problem, you have essentially a smooth function on the compact set. So you can apply Frank-Wolfe. So first, you should not say any more Frank-Wolfe. It's Frank-Wolfe because she is French, Marguerite Frank. So you can apply Frank-Wolfe, so namely that you can compute the gradient of this, then maximize the linear function, and then take a step towards that maximizer. So now if you look carefully, those two problems are essentially equivalent. So the way to do it, first is to see what is the gradient. A gradient is obtained by maximizing the linear function. Okay? And then you can reorder terms. Okay, you put all the terms with xt minus 1 in one spot and all the other terms in the on the right. And what you obtain is exactly this. You first compute a subgradient, which is obtained like this. And then your step is exactly this. Okay, so just rewriting, reshuffling the terms. And you can do the same. In fact, not at all. It's already in that format for conditional gradient. Simply, now you need to match this to this. And the matching is obtained with that formula. Okay, so essentially, for that very simple problem, subgradient descent is equivalent to conditional gradient. Okay, so this is an exact equivalence in that setup. Now we can do a bit more. So we can look at the general problem which I have described just earlier. But now I have to consider a bit more involved algorithm, which is a mirror descent. So for simplicity, I'm going to assume that H prime is a bijection from the entire of the domain to RP. So for the experts, this H is essentially smooth. So once you have this, you can define the Bregman divergence, okay, which is simply the it's classical in optimization. So if H is a square norm like before, the Bregman divergence is simply the square norm of the difference. Okay, so if you wish, imagine that H is a square norm, and then this is the square norm of the difference. And now I'm going to consider the mirror descent recursion. So this has been, I think, launched by Nemirovsky and has been used a lot since. So the way you do it, you also linearize your function, okay? So this g primal is my function. And then in order to avoid going too far, I add a proximal term, which will avoid x to go too far away from xt minus 1, okay? And if you just rewrite this, so let's try to rewrite this. So g primal, the derivative of this h, you get that, you get this, okay? And then by expanding the Bregman divergence, you obtain, after reshuffling of the terms, a simple formula like this, okay? So I won't do all the steps, but at the end, simply by reshuffling, you obtain something like this. And now, since H prime is a bijection, you can see this. This is equivalent to taking the derivative and putting it to zero, and you obtain the update in terms of H prime. Okay, so this is simply a reshuffling of the equation, nothing really hard going on. So let me rewrite now. The recursion. Okay, and it starts to look like Frank-Wolfe. Okay, so you first you have a maximizer over a compact set, then you take a convex combination of things, and in fact you can rewrite this by using a new variable. So if you assume that h prime x and y are linked to this, then you may rewrite that recursion by first computing a gradient of h star, then maximizing a linear function. But now this is where the difference lies. You have a term, okay? So if h star is zero, you exactly get conditional gradient. But now you have a new term, okay? And that term I refer to as generalized conditional gradient. But the algorithm is the same. You want to maximize a smooth term plus a term for which you can know you know how to do some operations on it. You first compute the gradient, then solve the linearized h, solve as is, and do a small step. Okay, so this is a bit related to proximal methods. For proximal methods, you assume that you can not only minimize linear functions, but you can minimize quadratic functions. Okay, so here, this is adapted to cases where you know a bit less about the problem. So when I started to work on this last year, so my goal, I knew that this was existing, but I didn't know where. And so I put online the paper like last year. And after a week, I received a message from Mr. Bredis telling me that this new algorithm, generalized conditional gradient, was already existing. Okay, essentially, what I was doing is simply providing a new interpretation and a new proof, a new simpler proof. And I discovered this morning that also people had considered similar equivalences, like Rob Freund and Gregas. It's not totally equivalent, but essentially this is the same type of equivalence. So what is not about that equivalence? So I think there are several things. The first one is you can get primal dual guarantees, so essentially extending the work of Martin Yagi for all of those cases. Okay, so you have primal dual guarantees, which are important in practice. Also, if you take the line search for conditional gradient, this provides an adaptive step for subgradient descent or for mirror descent, which is very similar to Polyak's rule. And finally, I think this is really what I think is the most important, is that whenever you make a progress on one side, you make a progress on the other side. So if you take the nice paper of Simon and Martin, if they can get a linear convergence rate for conditional gradient, then they get a linear convergence rate for subgradient descent, or for those problems which our method applies to. Okay, so this is simply, I think, a good way to transfer results from one problem to the other. Okay, there's also other equivalency which I won't talk too much about. This is if you want to go to bigger, to like steps which takes longer, and I just took a sub problem, again, when F star is zero, then you have something known as either simplicial methods or fully corrective steps, where instead of just doing a step between your current iterate and the new vertex of your convex set, you minimize over the entire convex hull. Okay, this is often called simplicial. It's a bit more expensive because you have to solve the quadratic program. But the key aspect is that this will be finitely convergent when your set C is a polytop. Okay, so in the context of submodular function minimization, this is really a good thing because you really want to have low precisions and often to get the exact optimal solution. Okay, so this is used a lot, in fact, for submodular function minimization. Question, does it converge better? This is not totally clear for the moment. So this is seen in the dual, but in the primal, it's essentially a bundle method where you, at every time step, you take all your iterates, xi, and you consider all the tangents at xi. So you take since the function f is convex, you are always above your tangents, so you're always above the max of the tangents. And if you form that new problem and you minimize it exactly, you obtain exactly the simplicial method. Okay, so this is also very very easy to see that those two methods are equivalent. Finally, another Wolf paper, which is just an implementation of that thing. Of course, when you want that QP, you can solve. And if you end up solving the QP with an active set method, you recover essentially the mean norm point algorithm by Wolf from 76. Okay, so. Another thing which is, I think, important and which does not lie into the equivalence which I have presented is considering penalized problems. Okay, so I think you have now a loss, typically logistic, and you don't want to constrain your norm. You want just to penalize by the norm. Okay, so I'm going to assume F is convex and smooth, and then the classical thing to do is to first, at every time step, to compute the gradient of the function. Take the essentially minimizer over the unit ball and then make a step towards that new value of x. Okay, and this has been, I think, done by Dudik and et al. And Archer et al. And Zeng et al. Also a bit by me. So at the end, you have many possible choices for rho and tau. Okay, you can simply either fix rho to 1 over t or optimize dual line search. There are many possibilities. But at the end, they all get the same convergence rate of 1 over t. Also, something which I've done recently is you can allow for multiplicative gaps. So what do I mean by multiplicative gaps? I mean that in many cases, so you cannot compute the dual norm exactly, but you only have an inexact oracle for the dual norm. And in many cases, well, in some cases at least, given x, okay, now given y, okay, you want to find the point x which is dual to y for the norm omega. But you cannot do it exactly. You can only do it up to kappa. Kappa will be like a parameter which is greater than 1. So you can find x of unit norm so that this is always true, okay? Because omega star is the maximum of x transpose y with respect to omega x equals to 1. But you know that you have also a bound in the other direction of 1 over kappa. So this comes out a lot when you do like convex relaxations like that Ben Wecht was mentioning this morning. In particular, if you want to decompose a matrix as a sum of cut matrices, you get exactly something of that format. And this is different from additive errors. Okay, so Martin and also Simon have worked on additive errors. You cannot apply additive errors to that problem. And what I was able to get is that we get an approximate solution and with a gap, okay, of kappa minus 1 omega of x star being the optimal solution. So if kappa equals 1, so if you have the exact oracle, you get no approximation, but otherwise you get this approximation like this. Okay, then there's a very nice reformulation by, I think, Dudik et al., which is using gauge functions. So this is, I won't have time too much to present in all details, but essentially, you can see a norm as being the infimum of an L1 norm for parameters, so that X is a linear combination of all unit norm vectors. Okay, so this, the family I is very large. It is all a unit ball. And essentially, this is true for many like convex homogeneous functions. And if you reformulate the problem, the minimizing the, let's say, least square loss plus kappa times the norm, then you can simply write X as this, okay? And now what you end up with is the simple lasso. Okay, so this is a lasso problem. The difficulty being that the number of dimensions is not even uncountably infinite. Okay, so this is really seems a bit like impossible. But essentially, the algorithms which are presented at the previous slide can be applied as is, and this is just reformulating the algorithm from before using those notations. So every time step, you compute the gradient of the loss, you take the vector z, which has the largest norm, or the smallest dot product, and you make a step toward that z. Okay, so it's exactly the same algorithm as the previous slide, but I think it has this nice interpretation in terms of lasso in infinite dimensions. Then there's also even a nicer interpretation for basis pursuit and matching pursuit. Okay, so if you take this case, and you take kappa to zero, okay, so what you should solve, you solve like essentially, you want to minimize this plus a tiny bit of that. So if you divide by kappa, you end up solving basis pursuit. You want to approximate y equals to ax, and you want the norm of x to be as minimal as possible. So essentially, this with kappa equal to zero should solve the basis pursuit problem. Okay. So essentially, this is the algorithm presented in the statistical literature, which is called a relaxed greedy approximation, but with a tiny difference is that you don't optimize our rho. Okay. So at every time step, you make a step towards the new vector, and you shrink the old vector by a constant amount, and typically 1/t or 2/t+1. And at the end, if you take this, you can show it converges to the solution of the basis pursuit problem. Okay, so it's simply a trivial consequence of the result above. And what is amazing is that if you look at what is matching pursuit is essentially the exact same algorithm without shrinkage. Okay, so if you take matching pursuit, so this is a nice work by our colleague Stéphane Malin, you did the exact same thing. At every time step, you take your residual and you want to you add the vector which has the largest or the smallest norm. You optimize tau in closed form, but then you take a step towards that new vector z, but you don't shrink. So essentially, you have very tight links between matching pursuit and basis pursuit. It's simply one is shrinking a bit the other. So at the end, those two are really similar. One piece of advertisement for Stéphane. His paper, so I reread recently, it's a very good paper in particular. This like, approximate oracle thing is already in there. Okay, so those guys already had it all 20 years ago. Okay, so just to finish, a last piece of work is herding. But before that, a bit of what? So what is herding? So I have to admit that when Simon joined the lab, I had no clue about what herding was. I read the paper and I still didn't have a clue. So let me try to explain my own words. So what is herding? The goal is you're being given some feature map. Okay, so X might be any input space, so you can think about like a Markov random field, for example. And Okay, so let's say you have like say X is a hypercube because you have binary random variables, and phi might be like all the pairwise products of variables, and the goal is you want to do to generate sample from the maximum entropy distribution. So if you were to do this, you would first need to estimate the maximum entropy distribution NP hand, and then to generate sample also NP hand. So the idea of Max Welling, maybe we can do this in one step. Okay, try to generate directly samples from the maximum entropy distribution without ever forming the distribution itself. So he has derived that algorithm, which I never understood. And I think the first step towards understanding was given by Chen, also Max, and Alex Mollard, which was reinterpreted as minimizing as minimizing the difference between the mu, so this is the expected sufficient statistics, minus an average of features taken at well-chosen points. So here, in Herding, the way they reformulate it, you want to find x1 to xn so that the empirical mean is as close to the actual mean. So why is it nice? Because then you can approximate integrals if you take a space f, a space of features which now is much bigger. So if f is a reproducing kernel Hilbert space, then you can see that if you take any function that in the Hilbert space, the expected value of that function for a certain density p of x, you can rewrite f of x using the classical representation theorem like this. Then you can put the expectation inside the sum. And if you define this as mu, essentially, computing integrals or averages is equivalent to a dot product by mu. Okay? And now, if you approximate mu by a sum of terms, then you can compute the empirical mean of f, and the error that you make will be bounded. Why? Because you can do the exact same manipulation with p hat. And I've heard that Cauchy means black in Hebrew, so Cauchy Schwarz is black. Using Cauchy Schwarz, this is by Shai. Is Shai around? Okay. And so if you use Cauchy Schwarz, you can show that the error that you make when you do when you approximate the integral by the empirical sum is bounded by the difference in between mu and mu hat, where mu hat is the empirical mean. So here, of course, you have to be a bit critical about that thing. What would random sampling do? If you take random samples from P, what you would obtain is essentially mu minus mu hat should decrease as 1 over root n. Okay? So essentially, you want to beat 1 over root n, and we will see that this is not always the case. Okay, so now let's try to understand what this means. Okay? And you can see that you have argmax and you have steps, so it may look a bit like Frank-Wolfe. And in fact, it does. So you have to define a specific setup. So we call like m the marginal polytop. So if you take all possible values of my input vector and I take phi of x, it's a big set. And if you take its convex hull, you get the marginal polytop. So here it's a very simple marginal polytop. And what you can see in the two lines of computation, just calculus, and this is joint work with Simon and Guillaume, is that if you, let's say, solve that problem, okay? So that problem is totally trivial. Why? Because you want to minimize, with respect to z, the distance to mu. Since mu is in the polytop, because it has to be an average of phi of x, the solution is mu. Okay? So at the end, you create a trivial optimization problem. And if you solve that trivial optimization problem using Frank-Wolfe, what you obtain, and exactly the Herding recursion, that with a small change of variable, but at the end, Herding heads up being another instance of Frank-Wolfe algorithms. Okay, and at the end, at every time step, the Frank-Wolfe step will start by computing the gradient of that guy. So the gradient of this will be this, by minus this, and you maximize over the marginal polytope. But when you maximize over a hull, you can restrict this maximization over all the vertices. Essentially, you obtain a pseudo-sample xt plus 1. So there are several strategies for this, which we have explored. And let's now look at confidence rates. So let me remind you that you want to beat 1 over root t. If you do 1 over root t, or below 1 over root t, or equal to 1 over root t, you're just doing worse than random sampling. So if you make no assumptions whatsoever, then we can recover the classical Frank-Wolfe steps. And if you take like 1 over t plus 1, the square is O of 1 over t. So you get O of 1 over root t. So at the end, if you make no assumptions, you're not going to prove anything good in terms of approximation of integrals. But now if you assume that mu is in the interior, okay, so here an instance of mu in the interior, then you can use existing results. And if you do a simple step size like this, or I think it also works with 1 over t plus 1, then you can show, and this was shown by Shen, that you improve from 1 over root t to 1 over t. So now you can probably show that you can approximate integrals in a better way. And better, if you do a line search, if you reuse results from Gellar and Marcotte, then you get a linear convergence rate. Why? Because you have a strongly convex function, and you assume the global optimum is in the interior. Problem is that assumption really a good one? So we have two propositions, one positive one and one negative one. So the positive one is if you assume F is finite dimensional, so if you have, for example, a Markov random field, and if your density is everywhere positive, then mu is in the interior. Okay, so you can use those rates efficiently. However, if F is infinite dimensional, so if you want to do really approximate integrals using like a Hilbert space, we show that, of course, under certain conditions, you can never be in the interior. So that rates, those rates never apply. Open problem is still worse in practice. Okay, so in practice, if you apply Frank-Wolfe without line search, what you end up with is with an empirical convergence rate of 1 over t in some situations, or 1 over t for this, so 1 over t squared for the convex problem. I've been trying and with Simon to explain this, and we are not able to do it for the moment. Just to conclude, some open issues and interesting problems. So the thing that I like about herding is that it looks at an optimization algorithm from a very different perspective. So what we care about mostly in optimization is that you want the iterate to converge. Okay, so the function values is what is important. For herding, what you care about is what the steps that you take, okay, so all the xt plus one, how do they look like? Okay, essentially, you want to characterize the distribution of the iterates. And this is tough, and I think quite interesting. Also, I think this idea of creating a trivial problem and solve it using Frank-Wolfe may have some other applications. I haven't found any, but some people might. Finally, other more classical optimization things, stochastic Frank-Wolfe. Okay, so this is something which is not, to the best of my knowledge, has not been done before. And it would be nice to see that if you can get good convergence rate by using those stochasticity or stochastic gradient type of techniques. And finally, since my main motivation for looking at those algorithms were to do subnodular function minimization, can you improve on the rates? Okay, so if you do the fully corrective, it's very slow. Okay, so it's decently fast, but you have a small number of iterations, but every iteration may be very costly. And it might be interesting to do partial corrections. So you don't optimize over the entire convex hull, but maybe with a few gradient steps. And of course, what you would like here is to improve on the convergence rate. But for the moment, we don't have anything going for this. Thank you for your attention.
Any questions? If you go back, I think one slide.
Yeah,
this one. So the P you're mentioning is the maximum entropy distribution.
No, P.
It's not the distribution from which you drew the sample.
Yeah, so here, in the context of approximate integrals, you have a distribution, and you want to estimate the expectation of any function under that distribution, and P is that distribution. So you need to have support everywhere.
That's why I'm a bit slow.
I didn't say anything.
I still think that the original problem where you have an empirical distribution and you try to model it by a full distribution, and the other, the P you're modeling, it usually has full support, even though the empirical distribution didn't have full support.
Correct.
So that's why I'm just wondering which one it is here.
So this is the true distribution.
Okay. And is there any insight on what the empirical distribution? What does that imply on the conditional empirical distribution?
If you have enough samples, it's the same.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Could you explain, what is the intuition behind proposition 2? Why is this never possible?
Why? Because in infinite dimensions, typically, if you take any finite dimensional cut, you get in the interior. But at every new dimension, you get closer and closer. So imagine you have let's say if you have diagonal, typically you have the many dimensions, and since you're in a Hilbert space with a finite trace, you need the sum of the width of your space has to go to zero. So it means that at the end, you add more dimensions, but are of decreasing and diminishing weight. In fact, Hilbert spaces are not really infinite dimensional, because the contribution of any new dimension goes to zero. And this is why, at the end, you cannot be in the interior.
But given any finite number of samples, you will be, but you'll get closer and closer to the boundary. Is that the case?
You will never be. If you have a finite number of samples, you're really on the boundary.
Okay.
So you have to imagine that in Hilbert space, you have many more dimensions.
So when you say stochastic conditional gradient, what part are you imagining being stochastic?
Any.
So ideally, what you would like essentially to be able to do the boosting thing in so if you take this, I say pop up. I'm going to find it. No. You want to solve that problem. You want to solve that problem, and you only want to assume that you have an oracle for omega star. Okay. So if you know a proximal oracle for omega. So you already have methods which are good. You want to be able to do the same with only a first order oracle of omega star.
So you want a stochastic oracle for omega star? Is that the idea?
No, we'll be more stochastic on F.
Oh, okay.
Typically, in that setup, F is the sum of terms, and then A, the rows of A are your data points. So you want to be stochastic in sampling the rows of your matrix A.
Questions? So just a comment on your very last slide.
Mm-hmm.
There is another interesting trivial optimization problem mm-hmm. for which Frank-Wolfe contributes, mm-hmm. which is something to do. It's a graph theory problem where you're trying to approximate a graph with very few edges, or either that or very few vertices, and. So you know the exact answer, which is the full graph. Mm-hmm. And the question is, and there's a metric for the extent of the approximation. And Mike Todd showed that Frank-Wolfe gives a very nice proof of and a much simpler proof of a known existing result on graph approximation.
I think this is true for other problems in theoretical computer science, where they reuse that algorithm and always reprove it. And claiming it's new for approximating a graph by a sum of cut matrices. This is an instance of Frank-Wolfe, and maybe what you describe is also an instance of that thing. Yeah.
So as a closer comment, while we have you on TV, do you have any comment or opinion about conditional gradient versus Frank-Wolfe as a terminology for this algorithm?
So I like Frank-Wolfe because so the first name of Mrs. Frank is Marguerite, and Marguerite is the second name of both my wife and my daughter, and so I prefer Frank-Wolfe.
Okay, that's a very nice close comment. Thanks, guys.